Hi, I'm Margaret Thompson. Before I continue, please like and subscribe to hear more stories like mine. Life has a way of throwing curveballs when you least expect them, and boy, did I get a doozy. But let me start from the beginning. Frank and I have lived in our cozy little house on Maple Street for 35 years now. It's nothing fancy, but it's home. We've poured our hearts and savings into this place, watching our son Jason grow up within these walls. Now at 62, Frank and I thought we'd be settling into a peaceful retirement. Little did we know what was coming our way. "Marge, have you seen my glasses?" Frank's voice echoed from the living room. I chuckled. "Check your head, dear. You're wearing them." That's our life. Comfortable, a bit forgetful, but full of love. Our son Jason, now 32 and working in tech, visits us often with his new wife, Vanessa. She's a looker, I'll give her that. But something about her always seemed off. "Mom, Dad, we're here!" Jason's voice rang out as they walked in one Sunday afternoon. "In the kitchen, sweetie," I called back, pulling a fresh apple pie from the oven. Vanessa wrinkled her nose slightly. "Oh, pie again? You shouldn't have gone to the trouble, Margaret." I bit my tongue. That girl never seemed to appreciate anything. Our neighbors, Bill and Susan, popped by later that day. "Something smells delicious, Marge," Bill exclaimed, eyeing the pie cooling on the windowsill. "Come on in, you two," Frank ushered them inside. "Jason and Vanessa are here, too." We all gathered in the living room, chatting about neighborhood gossip and reminiscing about old times. My sister Linda called, and I put her on speakerphone to join the conversation. "Remember when we couldn't afford new shoes for Jason's first day of high school?" Frank chuckled, a hint of past worry in his eyes. I nodded. "We ate ramen for a month, but our boy went to school looking sharp." Jason looked uncomfortable. "Mom, Dad, you didn't have to do that." "Of course we did, honey. That's what parents do," I said, patting his hand. Vanessa shifted in her seat, looking bored. "Jason, didn't you have some news?" Jason's face lit up. "Oh yeah, Mom, Dad, I got promoted at work. I'm now heading up the entire software development team." Frank and I were over the moon. "That's wonderful, son," Frank exclaimed, pulling Jason into a bear hug. "We should celebrate," I suggested, already planning a special dinner in my head. Vanessa cleared her throat. "Actually, we have some big news to share. Why don't we all have dinner here next Friday? We can tell you then." I couldn't help but notice the glint in Vanessa's eye. It made me uneasy, but I pushed the feeling aside. "Of course, darling. We'd love that," I said, trying to match her enthusiasm. As they left that evening, I couldn't shake the feeling that something was off. But looking at Frank's proud smile as he waved goodbye to our son, I decided to focus on the positive. Our boy was moving up in the world, and we had a lovely family dinner to look forward to. The big day finally arrived, and I spent hours preparing a special meal for Jason and Vanessa. As we sat down to eat, the tension in the air was palpable.
"So, what's this big news you wanted to share?" Frank asked, trying to lighten the mood.
Jason cleared his throat.
"Well, with my new promotion, Vanessa and I have been thinking about our future. We found this amazing house in Oakwood Estates."
Vanessa chimed in, her eyes gleaming. "It's absolutely gorgeous. 5 bedrooms, a pool, everything we've ever dreamed of." I felt a knot forming in my stomach. "That sounds expensive."
"Well, that's the thing," Jason said, looking uncomfortable.
"We need a bit of help with the down payment." Vanessa leaned forward. "We were thinking your house is really too big for just the two of you now. If you sold it, you could easily downsize to something more comfortable and help us out at the same time." I nearly choked on my wine. "Sell our home? But this is where we raised Jason. All our memories are here." Frank's face had turned red. "Now wait just a minute."
"Dad, hear me out," Jason interrupted. "It's a smart financial move. Property values in this area are at an all-time high. You could make a killing."
I couldn't believe what I was hearing.
"Jason, this is our home. We can't just—"
"We'll set you up in a nice apartment or small house with the proceeds," Jason promised.
You won't have to worry about maintenance anymore. It'll be perfect. Frank and I exchanged glances. The hurt in his eyes mirrored my own. But Jason looked so hopeful, so excited about his future. We'll think about it, I said finally, my voice barely a whisper. The next few weeks were a blur. Against our better judgment, we agreed to sell. The house sold quickly, and before we knew it, moving day arrived. Don't worry, Mom, Jason assured me as we packed up the last of our belongings. We've found a great place for you and Dad. But when we arrived at our new home, my heart sank. It was a small, rundown trailer on the outskirts of town. There were some unexpected expenses with the new house, Vanessa explained, not quite meeting our eyes. This was the best we could do for now. I couldn't speak. Frank's hand tightened on mine as we watched Jason and Vanessa drive away in their shiny new car. Weeks passed. We struggled to adjust to life in the trailer park. One day, while having coffee at the local diner, I overheard some gossip that made my blood run cold. Did you hear about that fancy party at the new mansion in Oakwood Estates? One woman said to another. I heard they had a champagne fountain and a live band. Oh, yeah, my niece was a server there, her friend replied. Said it was the most extravagant thing she'd ever seen. But get this, the couple who threw it? Apparently they kicked the guy's parents out of their home to buy the place. I felt like I couldn't breathe. Frank saw my face and quickly paid the bill, ushering me out. How could he do this to us, Frank? I sobbed once we were outside. Our own son. Frank held me close, his voice thick with emotion. I don't know, Marge. I just don't know. As we walked back to our trailer, the full weight of our son's betrayal settled over us like a heavy blanket. We had given him everything, and this was how he repaid us. The road ahead looked dark and uncertain, but at least we had each other. Little did we know this was just the beginning of our journey to reclaim our dignity and find justice. Life in the trailer park was a far cry from the comfortable existence we once knew. Every day brought new challenges: a leaky roof, faulty plumbing, the constant struggle to make ends meet. The silence from Jason was deafening. When he did call, it was always the same. Sorry, Mom. We're just so busy with the new house. Maybe next week? I'd hang up, fighting back tears. Frank tried to put on a brave face, but I could see the toll it was taking on him. He'd sit for hours, staring blankly at the TV, a shell of the man he once was. One day, I'd had enough. I'm going to volunteer at the community center, I announced. We can't keep living like this. At first, Frank just grunted in response. But as the days passed, I noticed a change in him too. He started offering to help our neighbors with small repairs, his eyes regaining some of their old spark. At the community center, I met Diane. She was organizing a food drive, her energy infectious. Margaret, right? We could use an extra pair of hands sorting these donations. As we worked, I found myself opening up to her. She listened intently, her brow furrowing. Honey, I hate to say this, but it sounds like you've been taken for a ride. Have you considered legal action? I was shocked. But he's our son. Diane's eyes softened. Sometimes the people closest to us can hurt us the most. You need to protect yourselves. Meanwhile, Frank had struck up a friendship with Tony, a former contractor living a few trailers down. One evening, he came home looking troubled. Marge, Tony's been hearing things about Jason and Vanessa. Over dinner, he shared what he'd learned: multiple loans, lavish spending. And Vanessa? She'd done this before. I can't believe it, I whispered, my hands shaking. How could we have been so blind? Frank reached across the table, taking my hand. We trusted our son, but now we fight back. The next day at the community center, I confided in Diane. Good, she said firmly. Document everything. And Margaret, don't let them get away with this. As I headed home, I felt a new resolve building within me. We'd given Jason everything, sacrificed our own comfort for his success. And this was how he repaid us? By abandoning us in this rundown trailer while he lived in luxury? No more. It was time to take action. I found Frank tinkering with our neighbor's broken air conditioner. "Frank," I said, my voice steady, "we need to talk about Jason and Vanessa." He looked up, a knowing glint in his eye. "I was thinking the same thing, Marge. It's time we stood up for ourselves." That evening, we sat at our small kitchen table, the journal between us. Each entry was a reminder of the pain we'd endured, but also of our resilience. We were no longer the naive, trusting parents who'd given up everything for their son. We were survivors, and we were ready to fight. "Where do we start?" Frank asked, determination etched on his face. I thought of Diane's advice, of Tony's information. "We start by getting smart," I replied. "We learn everything we can about their finances, about Vanessa's past. And then? Then we plan our next move." As we plotted late into the night, I felt a mix of sadness and resolve. Our son had betrayed us, but he'd also awakened a strength in us we didn't know we had. Whatever came next, we'd face it together. And this time, we wouldn't be the ones getting blindsided. The day we set our plan in motion, my hands were shaking so badly I could barely dial the phone. But hearing Linda's reassuring voice steeled my resolve. "You're doing the right thing, Marge. I'll start building the case for elder abuse right away." Meanwhile, Frank was meeting with Tony. "It's done," he reported back. "Tony's contact at Jason's company now has all the info on their financial shenanigans." We waited, hearts in our throats, for the dominoes to start falling. It didn't take long. One evening, the phone rang. It was Jason, his voice panicked. "Mom, there's some kind of audit at work. They're asking all these questions about our finances. What do I do?" I swallowed hard. "I don't know, Jason. Maybe you should talk to a lawyer." After I hung up, Frank squeezed my hand. "You did good, Marge. Remember, he brought this on himself." The next few weeks were a whirlwind. We heard through the grapevine that the IRS was sniffing around Jason and Vanessa's taxes. Then came the bombshell. Jason had been fired, accused of embezzlement. The final blow came when we learned the mansion was in foreclosure. It was time to make our move. We arranged to meet Jason at a small cafe. He looked terrible, unshaven, eyes red-rimmed. For a moment, I saw my little boy again. Then I remembered why we were here. "Jason," Frank began, his voice firm. "We know everything. The embezzlement, the tax fraud, how you manipulated us out of our home." Jason's face crumpled. "Mom, Dad, I'm so sorry. I never meant—" Defeated, Jason signed the papers we'd brought. As he stood to leave, he tried one last time. "Mom, Dad, please, can you ever forgive me?" I looked at him, this stranger wearing my son's face. "Goodbye, Jason. Don't contact us again." Watching him walk away, I felt a complex mix of emotions, sadness, relief, and finally, freedom. With the recouped assets, we bought a lovely little house in our old neighborhood. As we settled in, surrounded by boxes, Frank pulled me close. "We did it, Marge. We got our life back." Weeks later, we hosted a dinner party. Diane, Tony, Linda, and other friends who'd stood by us filled our new home with laughter and warmth. The room echoed with cheers. As I caught Frank's eye across the table, I knew we'd be okay. More than okay. We were survivors, and the best was yet to come. That's the end of my story, folks. Now I've got a question for you. If you were in my shoes, could you ever forgive a child who betrayed you so completely? Even if they came crawling back, begging for forgiveness? Think about it. We raised Jason, sacrificed everything for him, and he threw us away like yesterday's trash. Is there a point where a betrayal becomes unforgivable, even from your own flesh and blood? Share your thoughts in the comments below. I'm really curious to hear your perspectives on this. If you enjoyed this story and want to hear more like it, don't forget to hit that like button and subscribe to the channel. Your support means the world to us and helps us continue sharing these real-life experiences. Thanks for listening, and I look forward to reading your responses.